What's up, y'all? Entropy here. Welcome back to Eastern Michigan Eagles Dynasty. And today we'll be taking on the Northern Illinois Huskies. And just a fun fact, a little peek behind the curtain, if you will, of how the timing of all this has been going. I just finished watching Eastern Michigan play Northern Illinois in real life. And I am now going to be recording a video of us playing Northern Illinois in this dynasty. So that's pretty fun. The game was a good game. Eastern had a big lead and then they kind of blew it. And Northern Illinois had a final drive going, but they were in like, I think they were on their own 30 or something. And the game ended because it looked like they were trying to set up like some stupid, like crazy pitch the ball a million times play. But the guy that they threw it to just kind of decided to go out of bounds thinking there was going to be time left and there wasn't. And that's how the game ended. So it was a very entertaining watch in that respect, and hopefully today's goes similar. I am curious to look at Northern Illinois' schedule, but before I do that, I am going to actually throw a recruiting update in this episode. There hasn't been a ton of changes, but there have been a couple things that have happened that I just wanted to point out. So Dan Scott's still our guy at the running back position. We got a huge lead on him. We're kind of just waiting for him to commit at this point. I think he has 94 speed, which is faster than I think anyone else on this team. So he'll come in and be our fastest player right away, unless Cal or Wisconsin pulls a miracle comeback. But I don't think that's going to happen. Still got our fullback, Jeremy White. We don't use the fullback all that much, but just to have one, we're going to bring him in. Terribly low overall, but it doesn't really matter. JUCO receiver. I don't love bringing in JUCO players, but he was a 6'3 player with 95 speed. His catching is low for the 57, but his route running is also pretty good at 86. So I kind of liked what I saw out of him enough that I thought it'd be worth trying to bring him in. We got a lead on him, but he's not really like committed like Scott was. I can take Powell off of here. I'm actually not sure why he's still on here. but yeah, I don't like JUCO players just because they've got a couple years under their belt already, so you don't get them for 4 years. But our receiving core could really use a boost, so I'm going to bring him in. Receiver's a position I might try to address later as we get other commitments and I'm allowed to put some points elsewhere. Mangum. He's an interesting player just because we don't need a tight end, but he's 6'6". 79 speed isn't great, but he's got 75 trucking, 76 catching, and his route running is a 73. So I kind of like what I see from him. Plus, we have like the way our tight end room is we've got a junior. I can actually pull it up, but I just know this offhand. We've got one freshman, one sophomore, and one junior. So we're going to have the same three tight ends going into next season, unless one of them transfers or something. But I just thought it would be a good idea to bring in another tight end just so we'd have a fourth in case something happened. And then in the event that we can't dedicate points towards tight end next season for one reason or another, we could just bring him in. And I think when I had him up earlier, he was a 57 overall, but I actually scouted him and he went up 7 overall to a 64 now. So that would be nice if we were able to bring him in. We're competing with our fellow MAC Michigan schools for him. I'm not really going after the tackle, or am I? No, I'm not. So we still are leading on this other guard, even though we've already got one commit at the guard position. So I'm not putting any points in him, but he still we're still his leading candidate. So I think we even have a visit scheduled with him as well. We're still going after those pair of defensive ends, Kyle Newby and Caleb McMillan. We're in battles. Those probably won't be settled until after the season. Unless they're wowed by a visit. Newbie, we're only fighting with one team, really, unless Western starts really getting into it. But McMillan, I mean, you could throw all four teams in a hat, and it's hard to determine where he's going to go as of now. We already got one D-tackle commit, but I'm going for another guy as well, just because our entire defensive line needs some help. That's why I'm dedicating a lot of points towards it. So we'll see. Still leading on him. We're competing with Western, I believe, for this outside linebacker, Antonio Barrett. Our linebackers aren't great, as you guys have seen throughout this series. So it'd be nice to bring him in. Not going after the middle linebacker. Oh, no. I don't know why I have points in him, actually. So take those out. And now I have to figure out what to do with them. I'll probably just max out on this tight end. Just because we are behind on him. I'll probably cut this out, but I'll see you on the flip side of the cut when I figure out what I want to do with these points. Okay, so I pulled a pair of receivers from the recruiting board, Riley Smith and Reggie Lucas, and I don't think I have enough points to scout both of them. So what I'm probably going to do is I don't have enough points to scout both of them and offer them both a scholarship this week. So I'm going to scout them both and then determine which one I want to give the scholarship to this week just to try to get an early jump, I guess. They both have really low commit percentages, so they're not really set on anywhere yet. And neither of them are JUCO as well. They'll be coming in as incoming freshmen, so if I can nab one of them, that would really help as well. We're competing with some big-name teams, more specifically for Lucas, it looks like, than for Smith. I mean, Oklahoma and USC and A&M, of course, are big schools, but it's interesting that Syracuse is up there as well. So let's see what these guys got. So Riley Smith went down a little bit, only a 64 overall, 92 speed, 92 carrying, so he won't fumble the ball, which is nice. 57 catching. Man, a lot of these guys are not very good at catching, are they? decent route running, I guess, but not nearly as good as Claude Jackson's. I'm trying to look for anything I like aside from the speed, and I don't know if I'm really seeing it. 75 jumping. He is 6'4", which would be interesting, just because we could chuck it up to him. Let's see what Lucas is made of. He also went down. 92 speed as well. He's what, 6 foot, I think it was? Yeah, 6'2", 10. 92 speed, 90 acceleration. Riley Smith's acceleration is only 76. 83 jumping. Neither of them are very good after the catch, it looks like. Although Lucas's spin move and juke move are 65 and 71, so that's not bad, I guess. His catching is only a 68, his route running is only a 60. Oh my gosh. Release 65, same as Smith. This is a complete total coin flip. I don't know. One other thing I'm noticing is the bonus points thing. Riley Smith, we have a B+ in playing style, so that's contributing a little bit of extra points towards us, as opposed to Reggie Lucas, who, we're only getting 40 bonus points for. Well, I think we're just going to go with the... Oh, we actually don't have enough points for a scholarship for either one of them. I did that math totally wrong in my head. we're just going to dump our last points into Lucas. I mean, he's the higher overall receiver. All right, so continuing with... I believe we left off a middle linebacker because that, for some reason, still had points invested in Bolden. We've been locked out by Flowers for a while, but Zach Johnson, we're trying to put some points into. 6'1", 168. He's a gem. 91 speed, 83 zone, 80 man. I mean, honestly, that's enough to sell me. Speed in the 90s and good man and zone coverage. His tackling's not great, but that's fine. I don't need him to be a fantastic tackler as long as he can cover guys. So getting him would be nice because he's a 71 overall. He'd probably be... I mean, I can't remember Phil Moses' overall off the top of my head, but he'd probably be one of our best corners. Probably top two for sure. Stephen Blair's a strong safety. He's been committed for a while as well. We're still the leader on this punter, Dylan Mackey. Barring something unforeseen, we should be able to bring him in. And then, of course, the guy that I'm sure you all are most interested to see, we are still leading on five-star athlete Brian Thompson. Somehow, of course, the other teams have been gaining on us. Notre Dame's now only 130 points behind. And unfortunately, there's not much we can do. Just unless, because I can't level my coach enough to dump more points into Thompson. That's one of the upgrades you get higher up the skill tree. Excuse me. And then, and they also probably have more of the bonus points going towards them. The one thing we got going for us is playing time. But again, 90 speed, 91 throw power, 85 carrying. not particularly elusive, but he's fast enough and he has a good chance of not fumbling with the ball in his hands, and he can throw it far. The accuracy is a little low for my liking, but it can't be any worse than Bryan Matthews, so still would love to bring him in. I'm trying to be as reserved as possible in terms of getting excited about him, just because I still don't love our odds of bringing him in, but is what it is. So yeah, that is recruiting. So you guys got to see me in action a little bit there, trying to figure out what to do with those extra points I had left over. As always, I will update as things come out, as they should, as the season progresses. But we are getting ready to face the Northern Illinois Huskies. They were a team that I was worried about when I first started this, just because they did start out ranked because of Jordan Lynch being their quarterback. So let's look at who they have faced. So their one loss was at Iowa, okay? And Iowa is also 6-1 now, so they beat 0-7 Idaho. They beat an FCS school, 1-6 Purdue, 3-5 Kent State, 0-8 Akron, and then 2-6 Central. So they haven't faced a lot of good teams, and we, of course, are also not a good team, sitting at our 1-6 record, but it is what it is. So I still don't love our odds, simply because we are a 67 overall team, I believe, and they're a 70-something. Yeah, 79, so almost an 80 overall. So that's a significant gap, but as I say at the beginning of every episode, you never know. We'll see. What uniform should we rock today? Let's go with green, white, green. I'm sure we've worn this before. I've lost track, but it looks cool, so let's do it. And they have quite the high-powered offense there. 28th in points, 21st in total yards. 72nd in passing is surprising, just because I know they have a good quarterback. But their rushing offense at 14th, that is concerning, to say the least. And then their defense is also good, only 24 points per game. Our defense has got to be near the bottom. I'd be surprised if 126th isn't last place looking at our rush defense, but we haven't given up the most points somehow. So yeah, that Romero is Jordan Lynch. Not surprising, he's their best player by far. And then they got a free safety who's an 86 overall, and a halfback who's an 83 overall. Interestingly enough, their drop-off is pretty significant from player to player. So I don't know. Maybe they're not a very deep team. They got a corner out for the season with a broken elbow, and then they got their left tackle who is probable for this game. We've been very fortunate. Oh, I like their uniforms a lot. Those are nice. I'm kind of a sucker for a red and black combination. I just think it looks sick. So I love like Houston or Cincinnati. Those are two of my favorite schools for uniforms. But I forgot what I was saying. Oh, I remember what I was saying. We've been fortunate we haven't been hit by a lot of injuries this season, unlike a lot of our opponents. Of course, it hasn't mattered much, but still, it is nice. And here we are at Husky Stadium, very original, as the Eastern Michigan Eagles will be taking on the Northern Illinois Huskies. I try not to talk in the intro, the little intro clips video for the sake of theatrics, but is that a Husky statue an actual thing that they have? I've never seen that before in my life, but I just thought it was really funny. Because especially with like the graphics not being the best, it just looked like super nondescript. I don't know, I just thought that was funny. And Brock got knocked over. Uh-oh. Ooh. I saw a lot of green grass ahead of him, and I got very worried. Luke Romero did not have a great game in terms of completions and completion percentage, but some pretty big numbers nonetheless. We're going to come out in man coverage just because I actually did kind of like that in the last episode, even though we did not play particularly well. And there he goes. Both of our guys on the end got knocked over. As usual, the opponent's run blocking comes out strong as ever. Given that Jordan Lynch's one shot in the NFL did come as a running back, I guess we should be expecting a lot of read options today. Jackson could have made a play on that, but I was bad at pointing the joystick in a direction. I thought they were running another read option on that last play for sure. I was really surprised they actually passed it. Oh, there's the run. We might need to get lucky with some turnovers or something. I was right there. Gosh dang it. Well, they look pretty much unstoppable this drive, don't they? I got disconnected from Xbox Live. What? Hopefully that doesn't affect anything. In Madden, I would have got kicked out of this game, like, immediately. As Dale Malone gets through the tacklers for the touchdown, that was really fast. We're going to have to score a lot of points today, that's for sure. Here we go, studio update. I don't think we got any of these. Number 4 Michigan State goes down to Illinois. I feel like that's a very Michigan State thing to do. They'll probably beat Ohio State, though. And Iowa State shuts out number 8 Oklahoma State. Wow. Some other action. Toledo takes down Bowling Green. And Northwestern and Iowa are both ranked. I guess they're both ranked this season, actually, so that's not super surprising. By this season, I mean in real life. Northwestern's put together a nice season. They're very up and down. Some, like, they'll go from, like, competing for the Big Ten West to just being in the cellar, and then they'll come back, like, 2 seasons later, and they'll be relevant again, as Isaac Swanson takes this to, I'm going to guess, the 28-yard line? Dang it. Let's see if we can get anything going in the run game on this first play. That's a no. I will say, it seems as though after we won that game against Ball State when Brian Matthews was having a great day on the ground, it seems like a lot of teams have done a good job with shutting down Matthews. As he takes it for 13 yards, no one can stop Brian Matthews. Mm-hmm. I hate that more than... There are very few things I hate in games like this or Madden more than when you have a completion... Sometimes even a big completion, and that happens. It's just the most, like, demoralizing thing ever, because you know you have a big play, and, like, the guy gets there right as you're throwing the ball. Hold your blocks, hold your blocks, hold your blocks. Nice 6 yards for Brian Matthews to make this third and moderately short. I hate third downs on the opening drive, because I always feel an immense amount of pressure that I have to score on the opening drive, or we're definitely going to lose the game. Oh my gosh, really? That's how we're starting this off? Oh, that was a good play by that defender. I thought I could bloop it over him, but alas, like many other things this season, it did not work. I probably threw that way too late. What a weird play. The two defensive tackles drop back in coverage. I probably won't call this again. Yeah, I definitely won't call that again. Got him at the 1, but you can only assume it's a matter of time. Screw it, I'm sending 7. Oh my gosh, it worked. I'm just going to do it again. I'm just going to send 7 every play. I cannot believe this. It's actually working. There's a loss of 2 yards. That makes it 3rd and goal. This is the best our defense has looked all season. Yes, baby! Jason Cronin from the free safety blitz sacks Luke Romero on 3rd and goal, and the Huskies are going to have to settle for a field goal. What an incredible stand by the Eastern Michigan Eagles on the goal line. They knock it through for three, but it's okay. That's a whole lot better than seven. I'm pretty sure I literally said when we got him down at the one that it was only a matter of time, too. I love eating my own words sometimes. Oh gosh, no one blocked him. They finally stayed home on Matthews, but Phillips runs over a man for 3 yards. Wow, he came back so far for the ball, I thought it was definitely going to be a loss of yards, but he ended up somehow falling forward for three. Chavis looking like his normal dependable self again, getting us the big third down conversion. I don't know what's been up with him lately, but hopefully he starts to turn it around because we kind of need him. We are going to run the triple option here unless they show a defense that I don't like. Man, I'm fine with this. Let's do it. Fake to him. Good. Go out to the left. Pitch. I pitched too early. The other guy didn't bite on Matthews faking like he was going to keep it. But it's okay. Got us 6 yards. Man, Phillips just can't get it going in the run game anymore. It's unfortunate because he was pretty, like, dependable through the first few games of the year, but man, he's just not. He hasn't been the same. I kind of just threw that just because I didn't want to. I think I had the dump off to the right, but I didn't notice it till after I had panicked. I mean, if we're in their end, we might as well go for it, right? And Brandon Walker converts. Let's go. The problem with Phillips struggling is that I don't want to just run a read option every time because I know that Matthews is eventually going to fumble, even though he's kind of shown he doesn't normally do that. He fumbled in a recent game, I remember, and I can't remember which one, but so I feel like running the ball normally with Phillips kind of helps balance that out, but I don't know. If Phillips can't start to get it going here, then I'm going to have to come up with something else. Another 2 yards. I don't think it's entirely on Phillips. I think it's also our offensive line isn't very good. But, I mean, still. Good cut back by Matthews. He didn't get the first down, but that's okay because it looked, or rather, he got us close to it. That was a bad idea. Yep, I knew it. Sooner or later, I'll learn. I don't know why. Get over there. Oh, now I gotta cover him. Oh, it's a run play. Good. Oh, he fumbled. Get it. How in the world do we not recover that? We had at least three guys dive for it, and none of them got it. You gotta be kidding me. We can't even catch a break when it's right in front of us. That's really disappointing. You don't get fumbles very often in this game. I don't like the matchups being so far away from each other, but oh, it's a run. Good play by number 21. Is that Washington, I think? Mike Washington? Oh, they're running. Oh, good play by Williams. Oh, wow. Phil Moses got shook really hard. Nice play by Mike Washington there. Tackle for loss. I always appreciate in this franchise, or not franchise, in this dynasty, a good play against the run. Yes. If he pitched that, that was 100% a touchdown. There wasn't a soul over there. There was one guy, and he was getting blocked. This worked last time. Come on, Washington. Oh, he got blocked. But it's okay. We got the stop. Our red zone D is showing up today. I wish we could stop them before they got to the red zone, but nonetheless, they are playing well. Even though they're still scoring points on us, it actually gets me excited because it kind of is like, oh look, this defense isn't completely hopeless after all. Temple squeaked by SMU. Man, they had a receiver, or a tight end rather, with 150 yards. That's impressive. The kind of numbers TJ Hawkinson should be putting up for the Lions with where he was picked. Did he trip? Oh, that was nice. I think he got to 24. 23. There we go, Swanson. Beautiful. Oh gosh. I tried to throw it to Phillips in the flat, but it didn't work. I'm just gonna run. Oh no. Okay. They either went out of bounds or our guy got it. That's the important thing. And that's exactly why I don't want to run with Matthews too much, because I am wary of that happening.
Oh, that was so bad. I mean,
when I say he was open, he was wide open. That was like easy 10, 15 yards. Make a safety miss, you got a touchdown. Oh my gosh, that hurt. Some throws, man, just don't. He just does that sometimes. As Mario Landry. We have not said his name much, mostly because we haven't run that triple option a whole lot, but good play by him there. I know I need to look for those dump-offs more often because they're normally available. The problem is I'm so busy looking downfield looking for a bigger play that I never think. Oh, jeez. Yeah. That wasn't good. We need a big play, clearly. Trevor Morgan gives us a big play. Let's go. Clock's ticking. I don't want to give them enough time to like be able to drive on us, so I'm actually not gonna call a timeout here. Cause everyone who has been following this series knows how shaky our defense can be, especially like when the other team's running the 2 minute drill or less. Oh, get it. He got it. Matthews, you can't keep doing this, man. That's a touchdown. I know who's not getting player of the game unless he turns it around here. Jeez, oh, Pete, that's two big plays that Matthews has just blown on this drive. And he's just going to run this in, 100%. All is redeemed. Good job. Right, Matthews gets it to one score again. Big drive there. Great play by the offense all around. Guys are making catches, which was nice. I don't think we had a single drop on that drive. The incompletions were more on Matthews. And the extra point's good. Let's go. And we're definitely getting the ball second half. I actually remember this time. So that'll be nice. So as long as we keep them from doing anything stupid here, we'll go into the half down six. Nice play by Kaika Randall there on special teams. Wow. He's a big hitting wide receiver, if those exist. His stats are identical between the two quarters. The only difference is he threw a touchdown. I know calling man is probably risky because it opens up the big play opportunity, but I definitely don't trust my guys in zone. They seem lost. Yep. They do have all their timeouts, which is a problem. I was probably sitting too deep there. I was expecting one of the two receivers to cut in, but they both went out. I I know he got out of bounds, and that's bad for us, but that was pretty funny to watch because he was definitely trying to cut back upfield. Oh, what a play. Who was that? Was that Williamson? I think it was. Eugene Williamson busts through the line and gets a big sack there to make it 3rd and 16. And I think that'll probably stymie their drive completely. Yep, they let the clock run out. And we are going into the half only down 6. Which, with Matthews having 2 picks in the first half, that is astronomically good. Like, that early in the season, we'd probably be down at least 30 right now, having those turnovers. But the defense stood strong in the red zone, and it worked. It helped us a lot, for sure. Those field goals look a lot better now, that's for sure. And the second half is underway. Their kicker's kind of like ours. He can't quite kick it deep enough to force a touchback. And Swanson gets it out to the 20. This is probably a bad idea, but like, I'm determined for Phillips to get something going. Yeah, just 4 yards is better than 1, I guess. It gets him above 1 yard per carry, which is sad. That guy made a really good play. But Ryan Matthews is up the field! He's running! Can he win the foot race? He's being chased! He does! Ryan Matthews! I don't know how far that was, but that was a longest crap touchdown. Oh my gosh. And this game has turned around so fast. Thanks to Ryan Matthews' legs. Oh my gosh. I'm actually speechless. I didn't think that was going to go that far. Their one defensive lineman like split 2 of our blockers, and I thought I was going to get got in the backfield. But then the 2 blockers that he split went upfield and got the last 2 guys, and I just ran between them. Oh my gosh, as Ohio took down Miami University by 10. McClelland, the backup running back, because the other guy that got injured against us is still out. 36 carries. Oh my gosh, it's like Jonathan Taylor at Wisconsin. I was about to say, please don't let them take it back for a touchdown after we finally took the lead back. I'm expecting a read option here. If I had to predict what play. Nope, just a straight up pass. I called man, that was someone's man, but there was no man on him. Ooh, wow. I didn't think Washington actually had a chance at that, but good tackle. Oh, I wanted that pick so bad. I thought Williams had it. Oh, no. Big hit by Phil Moses. Wow. Oh, no. I am bad. Really? Oh, he's fast. Oh, wow. Did I blow that? Wow. That was terrible. I completely missed. I don't know what happened there with Washington, but then 25 just didn't really. I mean, he had a chance initially, but Carter just ran away with him, or from him. And they're going for 2? You know what? No, that's not what I want to switch to. I don't know why. I've had this problem where my heads-up display doesn't show up when I'm trying to audible. Are you kidding me? What the crap?! I apologize that that was loud, but that was... We can all agree that was stupid, right? I mean, give me a break. Alright, let's go put another drive together, I guess. Wow, look at that. It's almost identical. If they don't stay home on Matthews on this read option, I'll be shocked. They didn't. Incredible. I tried to run behind my linemen, but I ended up just kind of running into them, so that didn't really work. This is a situation where I would love to take a shot, but I don't know if this team is really capable of shots. I mean, we definitely don't get big plays very often, especially in the passing game. Most of our big plays have been runs, either by Matthews or Landry or whoever. I wanted B. Oh, no! I was hitting the Y button because he was so wide open. Wide open. That was terrible. I'm sorry. But I had Y 100% for a deep ball, and I got hit as I threw it again. Chavis gets the catch. I hate the fact that our drop problem has been so bad that I hold my breath every time I throw it, but like that's actually what it's come to. I'm just terrified they're just gonna drop every pass now. Oh man. Yeah. Ouch. I was hoping that would get us to like a 3rd and 5 situation, not 3rd and 9. We don't really have a go-to play for this situation yet, just because we haven't found a lot of plays that really work. Which is sad, considering this is, what, week 9? So, episode 8 of this. And we're still like, I don't know what play to run. Oh, wow, Isaiah Hayden with a beautiful catch. That was a nice throw by Matthews, too. He threaded the needle there. I didn't like the play. I didn't like that throw. I didn't want to have to try to make that, but I did, and it worked. If I get some blocks here, this might work really well. There we go, Phillips. Nice 8-yard rush for him. Finally got some blocking. The problem is he's not elusive, so it's kind of like first defender to him gets him. I don't like that. I don't like that. I don't know. Oh. This wasn't really... I don't know why the heads up display doesn't come up. I don't know what play I'm audibling to at any point. Get some blocks. He didn't get some blocks. This worked well. This has worked well, I should say, in the past, so. Holy crap. That worked really well. Normally you don't see the quarterback actually run. He kind of just falls forward, but interesting. This wasn't the play I called. Oh well. Oh, got some room. I thought I was going to get got like at the line of scrimmage. That's why I was surprised. Did he get hurt? Or is that guy just standing on him? I can never tell. Oh, Landry's in the game now. He might actually have gotten hurt. Shoot. Oh, well. At least Landry's not terrible. And the guy did the same thing he did on the touchdown, but that time he actually made the play on Matthews. That's unfortunate. Back spasms. That's not good. But we'll return soon, so... We won't force him back, though, for sure. It's been so money going to Chavis all game that I just wanted to go for it again. It was stupid on my part. I don't know if our field goal kicker has the leg for this. I hate going for it, but I don't want to miss the field goal. This might be the game. And Chavis makes the play. If I stiff-armed a little later, I might have actually done something, but instead he just kind of struck the Heisman pose for no reason. My heart was going very fast there just because I knew we needed to get that. Oh, and that's going to run out the third quarter. Oh, man. 21-14. The Northern Illinois Huskies are leading the Eastern Michigan Eagles. It's going to be an exciting fourth quarter. That is for sure. I didn't know how much of a chance we even had in this game because they're clearly a good team, but we have hung in there relatively well. I'm pretty proud of this team, I must say. Even though they've only beaten up on crap teams. Still, they are 6-1. We're 1-6. Oh, he actually shook that tackle, but there were a lot of other tackles to be made there. I'm going to go. Get the outside. Ouch. I don't know what I was thinking. I definitely should have gone out of bounds there, but he didn't fumble, and I don't think he got hurt, so we're good. He got hit so hard. Okay. Good old-fashioned mano-a-mano football. Let's see if we can get this. I don't know why I thought going outside was a good idea, but it didn't help that I got hit by the lineman. My own lineman, I should specify. Oh, that was my tight end, actually. What play did I call? Oh, I called a slants play. Get in the end zone. Yeah, baby. Brandon Walker with the touchdown. The guy who tripped up Landry on the previous play. Once again, for the second time, we've had a player redeem themselves by scoring a touchdown. So good on you, Brandon Walker. Yeah, looking at that leg, I think it was a good idea to go for it on fourth. I don't think we could have. We were at like the 33. I mean, that would have been a. Trying to do a quick math in my head. That would have been about a 50-yard field goal, I think. So I don't think we could have gotten that. In the newer Maddens, what's nice is that they'll actually like recommend you kick a field goal if your kicker can make it there, and if you can't, they won't. They'll recommend either a punt or that you go for it, depending on how close you are to the first down line. But this game's a little older, doesn't have that feature. I want to make a point about their offense so far, but I don't want to do it because I feel like if I do, it'll start happening. Ooh. Okay. Nice job, Cronin. I'm just going to say it, I guess. Their quarterback has not run nearly as much as I thought he would. He's been just kind of minding his own business, throwing the ball and handing it off. He hasn't done a lot of running, which is nice because our team is terrible at that. But, oh no. Oh, man. I mean, like, really? I mean, there was only one guy over there. And he got destroyed. And then 42 is there, but he got blocked. And Cronin almost made a play, but wasn't. I'm actually surprised he didn't trip him up. It looked like he 100% should have, but. This team just cannot catch a break. It looks like we're in it, and boom, a 77-yard screen pass for a touchdown, because why not? Oh my gosh, this running back's been more of a problem than the quarterback. Well, looks like we just got to make some more magic happen, don't we? Not getting a block there. Oh! I hate getting caught on my own blockers, because it slows you down so much. I'd like to run that wide receiver quick play I keep seeing, but I don't really have a receiver that I'd like to receive that handoff. Oh, Phillips is back. Oh, there he goes! Gosh, I wish he was faster. That was a touchdown. His 86 speed wasn't enough, but what a run by John Phillips. That might be his longest rush of the season, actually. Shook off one tackle. That power really showed there, but then couldn't quite run away from everybody else on the defense. But nonetheless, what a play. I don't know if there was a more open receiver, but I saw the edge rushers both coming around, and I got worried that I was going to get sacked. Oh, no!
Dang it! I saw it happening too late.
I saw that happening as I was hitting the button, and I couldn't do anything about it. I thought he was going to be very open. We have to go for this. I don't trust our defense to stop them. Chavis again, off of slants. Thank you so much for catching that. Oh, man. Gosh, their linemen keep doing that. They keep splitting. It's the same animation every time. They just keep splitting the both offensive linemen. And I hate it because it ruins the play. Ooh, I thought he might have got the first down there. My heart is going so fast right now. I was just prepared that we were going to get blown out again, but we are right in this game. As Matthews keeps it on the read option, is fighting but can't quite get there. Second and goal. Oh, come on. If you guys can't open a hole with that on the other side. As John Phillips runs it in for a touchdown. I don't know how much time is left, but I feel like it's too much. 38 seconds, and we might be able to work with that. And Waller thankfully knocks through the extra point. We have a tie game with 38 seconds left against the 6-1 Northern Illinois Huskies. Can you believe it? That took way too long. But it did burn an extra few seconds off the clock. They're running the ball? Oh, that's why they're running the ball. Oh my gosh, that was nearly a touchdown. He falls forward. This defense is about to it. They're about to do it. They're about to go get a field goal for a win. A run play? Are they dumb? I don't know how good their field goal kicker is. Maybe he's really good. He did not. What? Can I challenge that? There's no way he got a foot down. Are they saying that foot? It must. So his back foot must have been down. I can't. I'm so bad at working this stupid thing. Oh my gosh. You know what? I'm going to challenge it anyway. I have nothing to lose. That makes it first and 10. Back up that field goal. I mean, I guess, but man, that was so close.
After review of the play, the ruling on the field stands.
Whatever. I think that was pretty much our last hope, was that they would back up. Oh my gosh, a sack? Darrell Gilmore sacks Luke Romero in the back. Are they not going to call their timeout? They're not going to call a timeout. We're going to overtime. Oh my gosh.
I thought the game was lost.
This is unreal. I don't know. I don't know if I've ever actually been to overtime, even in like my own playing of this game. We want defense first. For sure. Okay. Well, here we are. College overtime is one of the most like thrilling things ever. In that it gets your adrenaline going, but man, is it nerve-wracking being either of the teams. This running back is just a big play waiting to happen. It's very annoying. Yeah, that was alarmingly easy. Give me a break. Oh my gosh. I mean, they just got, what was it, two plays? Oh yeah, 10 yards, 15 yards, easy. All right, we got an answer. That's why I like playing defense first, though. You know what you need to get. As number 6 Stanford goes down to Oregon State. Well, the Oregon State was 5-2 and wasn't ranked. Interesting. Oh yes, okay. I don't know why the game is lagging. But Brian Matthews gets a nice 15 yards off the read option. John Phillips punches it in for a touchdown. Woo, let's go. I'm starting to think crazy here. It's very clear our defense isn't going to be able to get the job done. What if we just go for 2 in the win here? I mean, it's gutsy as crap, but like if we do it, we just win. I'm actually going to pause the game and think about this. I mean, what as our defense stopped them? I mean, we forced 2 field goals in the red zone. But that was early in the game. Actually, can we look at that? I don't feel like going through all that. My point is, I don't think our defense has done a good job on them for most of this game. They definitely haven't punted. That much I know. We stopped them for 2 field goals, and then pretty sure every other drive they've gotten a touchdown. So... I can't believe I'm actually saying this, but we might end up, we could totally just go for two and the win, and whatever happens, happens. Let that be the outcome. Or we could extend this and try to just keep going with overtime. I don't trust our defense. We're going to go for this. We're just going to go for the win. Old reliable slants middle has worked well for us today. No! I hit the button and he didn't throw it! You hate to see that happen. Gosh dang it. We were in that game too and we 100% had a touchdown for the win. My plan was to roll out and then throw to either the dump off or the slant coming across. And instead, they just stayed home on the rollout.
Oh, man.
We were going to win that game. Let's take a look at the stats. Why does this keep happening? This happened at the end of the last episode, too. What is wrong with this game? Okay, we're going to look at the stats later. I am absolutely devastated. We haven't had a chance at a lot of wins this season, and then to blow it like that by taking a sack on the two-point conversion, that hurts. Oh, I guess, especially against a team that was 6-1. They were probably going to be the best MAC team we faced all year. And we just do that. Oh, my gosh. And that one's going to hurt for a while. We drop to 1-7. Just out of curiosity, did he ever have more than... No, the quarterback had two incompletions the entire game. One of them was the one where it was forced out by, I think, Washington or Williams, one of those guys, one of those corners. And I don't remember the other one, but there were only two. That's a little ridiculous. Anyway, Brian Matthews, 13 for 24, 138 yards. Not a big day through the air. He had one touchdown, though. And then the two picks that were early, but looked good aside from that. And then, of course, took the one sack. Brian Matthews had 20 rushes for 200 yards and two touchdowns. Wow. His longest was 76, so that's how long that touchdown was. And then John Phillips had a nice day as well. 12 for 71 and two touchdowns as well. Long of 32. That was that one where he busted through the line and then the defender fell off him. I wasn't expecting it. And then Landry had 2 for 5. Triple option once, and I think I ran another play with him when Phillips was out. Receiving, wow, that's not a big day receiving for anybody, but we only had 138 yards, so that's not surprising. Chavis, 4 for 47. No touchdowns for him, though. Mario Landry, 2 for 18. Hayden, 2 for 16. Brandon Walker had 2 for 14 and a touchdown on the one play. I think he might... Was he the guy that I was looking for on that last play? It was either him or Landry, I don't remember, that was in the flat on that two-point conversion that I was trying to get the ball to. But Trevor Morgan had a 21-yarder, Swanson had a 19-yarder, and John Phillips had a 3-yarder. Anyone have any drops? Brandon Walker had one. But I think that was one where the guy forced it out, so even though it's counted as a drop, I don't consider it a drop. Butler had the one pancake. Jimmy Butler, our tight end. And then Rodgers. I don't know who that is off the top of my head, but he was the one that gave up the sack. Oh, man. Defensively, Houston and Cronin were our two leading tacklers. They were a big play team. They had that running back that had the 80-yard screen pass, and then the quarterback was an issue as well. I mean, really, the only guy that hurt us was that running back. I don't even remember any of the receivers off the top of my head. They had the one guy, I guess, who I think might have been their tight end. He had a couple of their touchdowns, I think. Tackle for loss, Houston had one, Cronin had two, Washington had one. Lots of defensive backs getting involved there. Williamson had one. Zach Jude had one. Gilmore had one. Gilmore's, of course, was that sack that ended up forcing overtime, which was awesome. Williamson had one sack. And then Cronin had a sack as well. That was the one early in the game, I think, to force their first field goal. I know we didn't have any picks, any fumbles. We had one forced fumble by Houston. That was nice, but we were unable to recover it. and kicking. Waller did his thing, made all of our extra points. Good job. I'm sure he would have made that other extra point to extend the overtime period. I don't know. I'm trying to think if I actually regret going for the two-point conversion, because like, I still don't think our defense would have stopped them. Our defense didn't stop them from scoring ever. We had a couple nice red zone stops, but that's it. And those were early in the game. I mean, they were scoring from forever out. And their first overtime drive was too easy. So like, I think if I had to do it again, I probably would go for two again. It's just disappointing it couldn't go our way, especially because so few games have gone our way this season. And that would have been a huge win for us to take down a 6-1 Northern Illinois team. But anyway, continuing with the stats, Swanson had 6 kick returns for 135. There's not really much to say on that, I guess. We do have a coaching upgrade, so let's do that. We're going to, of course, put it into recruiting. I'd like to get this one at some point. I just question if we're going to need it this season. The only guy would be the 5-star recruit, but I don't know. It's hard to know like where we really stand with him. I'd also like to get this as well, which would give us extra points, which we could then throw it, which would actually, if I upgraded this, we could throw it into those receivers. I think we could actually do that just this week. So yeah, I'll do this. Offer him a scholarship and then dump the rest of these points into him. There we go. Maybe we try to get Riley Smith as well. I don't know. We're probably gonna have room for him in the class. But well, Lucas looks like the better receiver. His catching being higher is a big determining point for sure. Just because Claude also has 57 catching, so you know, it's important that your receivers can catch the ball. Might as well advance the week too. I guess we've kind of been doing that. We're gonna be on the road again at Toledo. Hopefully we can beat them. I think with how we played against Northern Illinois, it's kind of clear this team is figuring itself out. Yeah, I'm still bummed about losing that game the way we did. I mean, at least it wasn't like we fumbled on our last drive to force overtime or something like that. Oh, I forgot to give a player of the game. I'll give it to Gilmore for the sack, because I think that sack definitely forced them out of field goal range. I'm not sure if they were in field goal range to begin with or not, but they were 100% going for points there. So I'll give player of the game to Darrell Gilmore for this one. Cool. I don't think they were at level 3 already. Okay. We already knew about the guys that locked us out. Claude Jackson's ready to visit. Cool. Still in recruiting battles for the center and the left ends. Mangum's ready to visit, that tight end that I added. We're still in a recruiting battle with him. And Richard Cooper, that other defensive tackle, committed. So that's cool. So that's some extra points that we're going to be able to put towards somebody else. And then those two guys that I don't care about are also ready to visit, but I'm not going to schedule a visit with them because I don't want them. All right, well, I might as well do the coach upgrades as well while we're here. I'm going to go with stamina and injury. That's pretty important, especially because in the MAC, they like running those up-tempo offenses. Yeah, let's just max out. I'll probably max out the stamina on defense as well, but I remember we desperately needed to stop the run better. That's why I upgraded that to begin with. All right, and that is going to do it for today's episode. Again, thank you guys for tuning in and watching the downward spiral that the season has turned into. But if nothing else, I think that last game really shows that this team is starting to turn a corner a little bit. So hopefully we can beat Toledo. They're 3-5, so we should hopefully have a chance against them. But that will be seen in the next episode. Again, thank you guys for tuning in and watching. Even though it's as bad as the season has been, and as much as I've complained about certain plays or just the team in general, I have enjoyed this a lot. This has been a lot of fun, and I look forward to building this team up for sure. Starting from a 67 overall to hopefully competing for national championships eventually, but one step at a time, and this is just the first step. So thank you guys for watching, and I will see you guys in the next episode. Later, y'all.